الحمد لله الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم فملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم فالحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا والحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِنْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ اللَّهُمَّ لَا تَجْعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُعْرِضِينَ رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَاحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِّن لِّسَانِي يَفْقَهُوا قَوْلِي اللَّهُمَّ ثَبِّتْنَا عِندَ الْمَوْتِ بِلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ اللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين. At a previous occasion, I've spoken to you extensively about an ayah from Surah Al-Ahzab, and that ayah is about speaking clearly. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا. And I talked about the benefits of that particular ayah and what we can take away in our lives from it. So speaking clearly is one directive in the Quran, but speaking beautifully is another separate directive in the Quran. And that's what I'm going to speak to you about today, and the importance of beautiful speech and what it actually means and what that can, how that can better our lives if we just take this one thing that Allah has said and implement it. And in fact, it's not just something that benefits you and I, but if we fail to implement it, it brings a lot of chaos into life. And so we're gonna look at how that can affect your life and mine, and how we can perhaps protect ourselves from the damage it can do. So I want to start with something called iltifat. Iltifat means there is a sudden, all of a sudden, change. So for example, if I'm talking to one person, and all of a sudden I stop talking to them, and I start talking to somebody else. So I did iltifat from this person to that person. Or I could do an iltifat of a subject. I was talking to you about cars, and all of a sudden I started talking to you about the weather. That would be iltifat. There's a kind of iltifat in the Quran. It's done very, very strategically. Sometimes Allah talks about some people, and that's called the third person. So He's talking about them and they and the Israelites, or whoever, in this particular case, the Israelites. And all of a sudden, in the same ayah, by the time He gets to the end of the ayah, He's not saying they, He's saying you. So there's a switch from they to you. And that's a big switch. When you're talking to somebody and you're saying, I heard about them, they did this, they did this, they did this, you did this. You switched over from them to you. Those are two different groups, right? So what happens in this ayah that I'm about to share with you, the 83rd ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, is one this kind of iltifat. And I want your attention on that, because part of what we're going to learn has to do with this iltifat, this deliberate thing that Allah does in the Quran, this transition. So He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when we took the covenant, the promise from the children of Israel, that you shall not worship anyone other than Allah, and you will be the best you can possibly be with both your parents. So he's talking about what he said to them. You won't worship anyone other than Allah. You will be the best you can be to your parents and to close relatives and to the orphans and to those who can't help themselves, al-masakin. And you shall speak to people, وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا, and speak to people in the most beautiful way. Speak to people beautifully. That's what he told them. Speak to people kindly, beautifully, in a good way. وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةَ, and establish above and beyond all of that, establish the prayer, maintain the prayer, preserve the prayer, and give the charity that it's due to be given, the zakah. Then, so this started, all of this started with, they were given this promise. Then he says, then after that, I'll expect Allah to say, then after Allah took this promise from them, they turned away. Right? Because he took it from them, and they turned away. He says, ثُمَّ, instead of me hearing ثُمَّ تَوَلَّوْا إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْهُمْ وَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ قَالْ ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. You turned away, except for very few among you, while all of you were purposefully ignoring what was taught. All of you were deliberately ignoring. So we went from they to you. Now this is important for the Israelites, because when Allah gave them this, that was many, even though this is the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Allah gave them this instruction, it was given to them through Musa alayhi salam. That was thousands of years ago, even for them. And they've had many generations since then, and the Jewish community that the Quran is speaking to in Medina is actually thousands of years and many generations apart from the community from whom this promise was taken, the original children of Israel. You know, the ones that were given the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam. So what did Allah do? Allah, in one ayah, He spanned several centuries, He spanned several generations, and basically told them the same thing that was told to them. It's understood that it applied to all of you. And it's unfortunate that you people turned away. You people turned away. So Allah is making them concerned not with what the people in the past did, but what they're doing. ثُمَّ تَوَلَّيْتُمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. Now this becomes a direct criticism of the people that were actually alive and listening to the Prophet ﷺ. This isn't just, oh, the Israelites were given something and they didn't follow it in the past. He brought it into the present. And in doing so, he taught the Muslims something. That when Allah criticizes even those who made mistakes in history, or who were given a responsibility in history, but He switches it over across thousands of years to the present, that's the mindset I'm supposed to have towards the Quran. The words are alive, and I better, if Allah had blessed those people with revelation, and they ignored it, then now Allah has blessed you and me with revelation, are we ignoring it? And if we are ignoring it, then we're not that different from those same people that Allah criticizes and He calls them Banu Israel. That we're modeling the same behavior. So in doing so, Allah has given me a formula, right? And it's a pretty scary one. That if I behave, my attitude is the same as them, then I'm no different than them. The ones that Allah criticizes. Now having said all of that, look at the instructions inside of this ayah. They're the same ones we have in Islam. Don't worship anybody other than Allah. Be the best you can be to your parents. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدِينِ إِحْسَانًا. Then he says, after you're the best to your parents, then he goes on to, you know, وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ, closest relatives. After closest relatives, orphans. After orphans, those that are poor, those who can't help themselves. Now there's a progression. The closest one to you is Allah. You're the best to Allah. When you're the best to Allah, then the first demonstration of that is how you are going to be with your parents, the best you can possibly be. And if you have developed this gratitude to Allah and this appreciation of your parents and the excellence towards them, then it's not just, I'm good to my parents, but I hate my uncles. But I'm really good to my mom and dad, but my cousins, man, if they show their face. No, that transitions over to how you deal with others. And that the first recipient of your goodness is actually your siblings, your uncles, your cousins, your extended family, even your in-laws. These people that are close to you in your life, they become recipients of your goodness. It's remarkable that Allah is teaching a ripple effect here. It starts with Allah Himself. And then it goes over to parents. And then it goes over to extended family. And then he says it goes over to orphans. Why? Because you realize that family is a blessing. Parents are a blessing. And then there are those who don't have the blessing of parents. They've been tested with not having parents alive. Kids. So you develop a compassion for children that are tested with that. And you, and in this, what has Allah taught us? That worshiping Allah makes your heart soft towards the pain of others. It makes your heart soft towards the pain of others. Even others that you don't even know. Because this is something Allah put inside the heart of a believer and actually put inside the fitrah of a human being. It's in the nature of a human being to feel compassion for others that are suffering. So he says, wal yatama. And then the kids that are suffering, that's the first recipient of our mercy. So obviously children are given a priority. And then on top of that, he says, wal masakin. But it's not only kids. Anybody who's stuck in a situation where they can't help themselves, people that are economically stuck, people that have lost their job, people that are chronically ill and can't take care of themselves. There are all kinds of people that are in the category of masakin. Now you're concerned about them also. You're doing the best you can towards them as well. Anybody you can. And at the end of all of that, you say, well, I give charity. I'm good to my parents. I'm pretty decent with my family. And I take care of everybody else too. I check. I cover all those bases. Right? Even though for most of us, that's a really hard thing to do. For me and you, that might be really hard to do. Because some of the most epic drama that you face in your life comes from your family. Comes from siblings. Comes from uncles. Comes from parents. Comes from children. Comes from spouse. Right? So the most arguments you have are not with people that are 3 degrees of distance from you. They're the ones that are right next to you. They're the ones that give you and I the hardest time. And we give them the hardest time. And so if you pass through all of that, what does he say? وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا. It's interesting, he said, he could have not mentioned the maf'ul bihi or mutaalliq here, but he did. He says, and you're going to speak in the most beautiful way to people. In other words, it's not just, I take care of my people and everybody else, you better watch out. Nobody better mess with us, right? Before they get to put me down, I'm going to put them in their place. You have this kind of gangster mentality that I learned actually when I was in high school, when I came to the United States. It's the antithesis of what I had learned living in traditional Muslim societies. But when you come here, you have to become rough and you have to become, you know, aggressive almost. Why? Because if you come across that way, nobody will mess with you. Because the norm is somebody will put you down. Somebody will target you. Somebody will, you know, bully you in some way or the other. And you have to come across as someone who cannot be taken for a ride. You have to become tough, right? And in doing so, what's the best way to do so? Well, you got to learn some pretty bad language. If all your friends are cursing and everybody else is raising their voice and getting, you know, outrageous, you notice that the people that are the safest at school are the people that everybody else is scared of. So you better develop some scary, you know, qualities in your personality also, so that people don't mess with you, which is the opposite of وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ husna, speak kindly to people. So this is inculcated into us. It's put into us. And in fact, the only time people learn to speak nicely is when their life depends on it. Excuse me, officer, I'm so sorry I was speeding. That's the only time you're going to speak kindly, right? Or if your employer, your boss, you're going to speak kindly. Hey, sorry, boss. Hey, I'm really sorry I'm late. Or your teacher who's going to fail you, now you're going to speak kindly. In front of a judge in a courtroom, you'll speak kindly. But the waiter at a restaurant, why do you need to speak to them kindly? Hey, why are you late? Excuse me, I'm sitting over here. All of a sudden, the moment, you know, you don't get some benefit out of it or you're not scared of the person, then you can go back to your gangster ways. And you can put everybody else in their place, you know. You can yell and scream at the cash register guy. Or the, you know, the waiter at the restaurant or whoever else. Reminded of a story that a friend recently told me that they, you know, for in Ramadan, they went to iftar at a restaurant. It's very busy, right? And the iftar time came and they didn't get the food. And usually they serve dates, you know, at least you break your fast. But they didn't even serve the dates. And they prayed Maghrib and they're still waiting and they don't even have water or dates. And it's been 40 minutes. They haven't broken their fast. So, and you're already hungry, you know, so you're pretty upset. And the waiter keeps, the lady keeps passing by and she keeps like avoiding eye, you know, sometimes the waiters, they avoid eye contact on purpose, like, cause they'll, you'll give them the stare of death. They know that. So, So they know from the side of their eye, they can see and they ignore you and they just go, right? So finally, 40 minutes later, she brings the dates to the table and water. And one of the people sitting at the table said, did you break your fast? Because it's a Muslim lady. And she said, no. And she gave her date to her and said, why don't you break your fast? Now that's قُلُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا, right? But what would we do? What kind of restaurant is this? Let me speak to the manager. I mean, seriously, do you not see us here? You passed us by 40 times. Like this person didn't have an agenda to ruin your life and, you know, starve you to death so you suffer the consequences of not having iftar on time. They're also doing the best they can. But you know what this is? It's a lack of empathy. We're not able to, you know, there's a consistent, you know, logic developed in the Quran. First, you worship none other than Allah. And what does that do? That Allah knows all your faults. Allah knows all your faults. And then after Allah, the people who know you the way nobody else knows you is your parents. And you're good to your parents. And when you're good to your parents, you're good to family, and you know the trouble that happens in family. You know who's in trouble, you know who's having a hard time, you know who's sick. You learn to see people's pain when you're good to them. And as this, and then yatama and masakin, those are people that are in pain and suffering. So you realize, with that experience, you realize a lot of times people look okay on the outside, but they may not be doing okay. So I need to develop a kind of kindness in the way I speak to people. God knows what they've been going through. Allah only knows. So وَقُولُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنًا, just speak beautifully to people. Just speak kindly to people. And this was given, like, what baffles me is this was given to Musa alayhi salam, right? And Musa alayhi salam, remarkably, is actually these are children of Israel that started with Yusuf alayhi salam, you know, the sons of Israel, right? And Yaqub alayhi salam, that legacy. And in that legacy, the brothers of Yusuf used to speak bad about him. And so much disaster came in that family's life because of the way they spoke about each other and to each other. You know, the son spoke to the father badly. إِنَّكَ فِي ضَلَالِكَ الْقَدِيمِ, you're just confused old man again. طَلَّهِ تَفْتَأُ تَذْكُرُ يُوسُفُ, anger was expressed in that way. And now generations later, those children now have thousands and thousands of children. They're a nation now. And Allah gave them this vast law. Jewish law is actually pretty vast. I've spoken to rabbis before. They study their traditional books 14, 15 years and they still don't have a grasp of it. And they do 2 or 3 PhDs on average, some of their top scholars. 2 or 3 PhDs. And they're still, their hair's turned gray and they're still studying. They're called ahbar for a reason. Their hands were dipped in ink. And what did Allah do in this ayah? He took all of that law that they have and He summarized the essence of it. And part of the essence of it is speak kindly when you open your mouth. And nas is everybody. You know what that does? It includes my parents, it includes my spouse, it includes everybody. And the Prophet ﷺ says, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ, right? The best of you are the best to your families. You know what that means? That the best words I use should be for the husband, the wife, the mother, the father, the brother, the sister. They should get the best words. What happens in our families? If you invite somebody over, oh, they're coming. Clean up the house. Why is that there? What are you doing here? What are you doing? Oh my God, the rice still isn't done. Are you serious right now? And there's this like, it looks like an angry kitchen. And there's like a civil war happening inside the house. And then the bell rings. The guests come over, the bell rings. And all of a sudden, everybody becomes a model citizen. Assalamu alaikum, how are you? The worst of it is for your family, and the best of it is for strangers outside. And you should be good to strangers, but there's a principle here. The kindest words I use are supposed to be for my own family. In the smallest things, in the smallest things, you're sitting there at the breakfast table, and your wife left she didn't put, you like 2 spoons of sugar or whatever it is, because you want to make sure you get diabetes early, so you want 2 spoons of sugar. So she only put one. You notice her put one. Now at this moment, you have to decide, how am I going to let her know? I mean, choice A. You know you always do that, right? And you know I don't like it. and you do it on purpose because it really bothers me. And I hate that about you. I just want you to know that it's noted. Or you could also say, seriously, again? Again, right? Yeah, because I only need one, right? Yeah, because if your mother was here, she would have gotten three. But I only get one. I should even be, I mean, did you spin in it first? You have other comments you can make. Or you could just shut up and put it yourself and not say anything. You could do that. Because what if you just took a step back and say, what is going to come out of my mouth? Does it have any beauty in it? Is it going to make my life or anybody else's life even a little bit more beautiful? No. Go back to that waiter that, you know, served 40 minutes late. When a customer asks, have you had your iftar? And she gets that date. That might be the most beautiful moment of her day. That's just a small act of kindness. Might be the most beautiful moment of her day. If you can't say something good, and it's not that big of a deal, the sun will still rise. If you didn't put the sugar in the cup, the sun's still going to rise. You're still going to breathe oxygen. The universe will continue. You know, Allah hasn't brought it to an end. It's not the end of the world. Then maybe you shouldn't say it. And the same goes for the wife. Not everything has to be commented on. Not everything has to be critiqued. Sometimes these words, what do? They take the beauty away from a moment. You're enjoying something together and you say something negative. You know, why are you sitting like that? Why didn't you do this? Why did you do that? How come you didn't do this? And it's not even something bad. It's just, I just like to correct and correct and correct. You know, when you do that enough times, then what develops over time is a distance between family. You don't want to be, nobody likes to be around someone who's constantly criticizing. Nobody likes to be around someone who's always sarcastic. You don't pick friends like, if you have friends like that are always nitpicking, you stop calling them back. You stop not being around them. If your family becomes like that, if you become like that with each other as a spouse, if you become like that with each other as siblings or parents and children, then guess what? It's no surprise that you don't spend as much time with each other. In fact, every time you do spend a little bit of time together, the conversation, when it goes beyond 5 minutes, it becomes very, very negative. It just turns ugly. And you and I have been given the ability to realize when we are turning a conversation into something ugly. We've been given the ability to recognize that. The last thing I wanted to say here is a connection that's often not made, or at least in my view, not made enough. And I want everybody, myself also, to be aware of that. Allah has made us human beings with a whole set of emotions. In the course of a day, you can have any number of emotions. Your emotions could be anger, they could be sadness, they could be excitement, they could be you're just in a hurry, you're stressed, you have anxiety, it could be boredom. You could have any number of emotions throughout a day. Allah did not deny us feeling emotions. But what gift did He give us as believers? He, unlike others, what He gave us is, now that you have these emotions, others might say, somebody else who doesn't have this faith might say, well, I have the right to feel what I feel. I have a right to my feelings. But you know what they're saying? What they're actually saying is, I have a right to say whatever I want, however I want, because I have these feelings. Because I'm angry, that's why I said it. What do you think? I don't have a right to be upset? No, what the deen comes along and does is, you have a right to be upset. What you don't have a right to do is take your anger and use words now that are ugly. You can actually express your anger still with beautiful words without letting things get ugly. I didn't like what this was, and I want to make sure that this doesn't turn into something worse. If there's something you want to talk to your family about, that's negative. There's a positive way of bringing it up. There's a less sarcastic, less confrontational, less hurtful, less critical way of bringing it up. And you and I have to actually engage in this exercise. What's that exercise? I need to think a little bit before I open my mouth. Is there a less, because you know your wife better than anybody else. You know your husband better than anybody else. You know your family better than anybody else. You've had the same kind of fights a million times over. So now you're smart enough to know, if I use the same exact kind of words I did last time to express my frustration, that might not work out so well. That's going to be very hurtful. So I need to find better ways of communicating it. And that's قُلُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنَى. That's the essence of قُلُوا لِلنَّاسِ حُسْنَى. Words are not small things. People feel that they, like I said, with a police officer, with a judge, with everybody else, there are consequences for using words the wrong way. But your family, when we were engaged, then I was really careful about how I talked to her. But now we're married. Now she's stuck. Where's she going to go? Now I can speak to her. And she says, yeah, well, what's he going to do now? And then he says, you didn't talk to me like this before. And she says, yeah, because, I mean, that's not the time to do that. This is the time to do that. Because now I can truly express my feelings. No, expressing your feelings in a healthy way is what is needed. Because the best of it should come out with our families. And the consequence of that is dire. The very next ayah in the surah is about the Israelites killing each other. You know that? The very next ayah. There's a logical flow. Why? Because words cause wars. Words destroy families. There are things that were said to you years ago, you still remember them because they hurt you. You still remember them like they just happened. So on the one hand, people feel that their anger, their frustration, their whatever stress gives them license to speak however they speak. That's one thing that I want you to be mindful of, that you don't become like that, I don't become like that. The other side of it, and this is the last thing I'll share with you, is that you and I have to develop empathy. In other words, maybe you're not angry, maybe you're not upset, maybe you're not frustrated. Maybe you and I are just insensitive. Maybe we don't realize that the way we speak is hurtful. Just because I don't think it's hurtful doesn't mean that it's not hurtful. I have to, if the other person says, hey, the way you said that really hurt me.
You say, what? I said it normal. That's how I always tell it. I just called you fatty. But you are fat. I mean, I can't speak the truth anymore. You know, in Islam, we speak the truth. Now you could turn this in. You can become impossible. You could be obnoxious. You could turn it around. And when you do that, obviously you're not interested in conversation. You're interested in digging in your heels and making things worse, right? But if you really want to, like this takes iman in Allah. If you really you and I become mindful of Allah, then when someone points out that we've hurt them with our words, we will take that very seriously. And we will say, I really want to understand how I did that. I didn't realize it. Let me take a step back and think about that. And maybe they're right about something. Maybe there is something I could have changed. Maybe there is something I could have said better. Because if we don't do that, then I'm afraid for myself. You should be afraid for yourself. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. That the worst kind of hell is for people who speak behind people's back and hurt their feelings, or speak to them in their face and hurt their feelings. And the kul there means they come in all shapes and sizes. There are all kinds of phrases, expressions, facial expressions you can use, communication forms you can use, sarcasm you can use, that can categorize itself under lumaza, humaza and lumaza, in fact. So it's not just a thing, oh, you're just too sensitive. Why do you have to make a big deal out of it? Words are a big deal in this theme. Words are a big deal. And I don't want you to... As I speak this, I don't want you to take this, you know, where is this video getting posted? I need to share it with my wife. She really needs to hear this. Or I need to share it with my husband. He really needs to hear it. Oh, can I send this to all of my in-laws? Because they really need to hear this. You know, we all feel that somebody else needs to hear it, but Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, who wanted a message that everybody in the world should hear, used to say, "Usikum wa nafsi bi taqwallahi azza wa jal." I counsel you and I counsel myself of the taqwa of Allah. Like, you know, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. I'm from among the Muslims. I'm speaking to myself. I need to learn to speak to myself. I need to carefully analyze where am I falling short in this? And for any sincere believer, they will not turn this into a contest. You see, there's a khutbah that scores points against you. And this khutbah puts me, when you start using the religion to win a contest, then the deen of Allah is not supreme. Your ego is more supreme than the deen of Allah. right? So you and I have to humble ourselves to the word of Allah, and I pray for our own benefit and for the benefit of those that we love, that we become kinder with the words that we use with each other and become more mindful of speaking when things are going to have a beautiful consequence. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-Hakim. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله، اتقوا الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.